Hello, everyone, viewers of the Fuel Injection Podcast, and welcome to the next installment of Auto Banter. Today we have Diesel Crew on, and we're going to be talking about anything that comes to mind. We're doing one of our usual free forms, just kind of talk about anything podcast today. Although I do want to begin by talking about a post I saw on DriveShark. So there was a guy, a teenager from Florida, whose name begins with N and ends in Olin Carter, so it's Nolan Carter. And he he made a post, I think maybe last night or this morning, about some off-roading he had done with a friend. And he said that he almost flipped his friend's Jeep because he backed it into a ditch and then he had to winch it out. And the first thing that I thought of was, well, it's a Jeep, so it shouldn't need a winch to be able to get out of a ditch. Because if any of you have ever seen those videos of Jeeps going straight up like the sides of canyons and stuff, you will know that Jeeps do not need much of any kind of help to get out of a sticky situation. So I'm like, a winch? Like, come on, buddy. Come on.
Well, first of all, I've done my share of off-roading in a few different things. First of all, it depends on the spec of Jeep you have. Because if you have your basic, you know, bottom rung Jeep, you're talking something that doesn't have proper lockers. The four-wheel drive's not as good. And then it depends what type of tires he had on it. Because if you try to go off-roading on just your basic all-season highway tire, good luck. And then did it become, you know, how deep was the ditch? Because he could have high-sided as well. And was he off camp? There's a lot of questions there that would have to be answered to me. I've seen really good four-wheel drive stuck in some situations that you just sit there and go, I didn't think that was possible. I seen a four-wheel drive dually stuck in a wet field, just stuck, flat, wet field, grass, just plain grass, mowed and everything, stuck out there just spinning away and couldn't go anywhere. Could not go, had needed a tractor to go out and get it just because it was stuck in wet grass. So, and I would have to know more.
I mean, good point about the model of Jeep and the kind of kit he had on it. But, you know, he didn't put any specifications on what kind of Jeep, what kind of tires, or what kind of, if he had like a lift kit on it or any kind of like gripping, like good grippy tires or anything like that. So, you know, it is kind of difficult to know just how capable that Jeep was.
Jeep is quite a wide scale. It could be a Rubicon or a Renegade.
It
could be a Grand Cherokee or it could be a Gladiator, yeah.
Also, a ditch is a big thing. Is it a ditch that would sort of get? Is it a ditch that would get a couple of tires stuck, or is it a sinkhole? There is a massive gap.
Yeah, a ditch is a very broad term.
Is it quicksand, or is it an actual ditch?
That's why I always, my default, if you're going to go off-roading and do anything, it's Toyota Tacoma. Because I've been everywhere in one. And on the ditch note, you know, we have ditches around here that are barely 6 inches deep. They're just made to take a little bit of water and keep it away from the road type thing, to water washouts that can be 12 foot deep and 20 foot wide. Prime example, me and my cousin was in a first, well, it wasn't even a Tacoma. It was back when they called them the pickups. It was just a Toyota pickup. 90s model, and he ran around on, they were originally swampers, but by the time we were doing this run, they were basically baloney rinds. They were completely slick, except for a little side lug out on the side that hadn't wore off yet. And we was riding around in Southern Ohio, and he's like, hey, I got a friend that's got this ditch that says no truck can get out of it. And he goes, I want to see if I can. I'm like, okay, no problem. Let's go do it. And we had my quad runner in the back as well. So we threw the quad runner out. I get there, and I was like, well, where's this ditch at? And my cousin and his friend had been talking, and I walk over, and this ditch is probably 13 foot deep. And it is wide enough you could drive three cars side by side down in it. And I'm like, no, that's not a ditch. That's a gully. That's a very different thing. Yeah. And it was your typical, had rock bottom, you know, the whole bit. And where they were looking at, it was literally that, straight up. Oh. And my cousin's like, yeah, we can do it. And I'm like, I don't see this going well. And the guy proceeded to tell us about trucks that had tried it and literally just fell over on their top. And I'm like, oh, yay. And of course, my cousin asked me, he's like, right? My cousin asked me, do you want to go with me? And I'm like, well, yeah, you know, ride or die. We got to do this. So we jump in, and you have to go down around and go down quite a hill just to get into this ditch. So we drive on up, and the guy's standing there. He goes, right here. You know, he's pointing us where we need to go. And you know you're in for a bad run when you come up and your front bumper just goes da-goonga into the sidewall of the ditch. And I'm like, dude, we don't even have the breakover, or not the breakover, but the incline to get it, you know, going up that wall.
Yeah, the approach
angle. Yeah, approach angle was not happening. So my cousin's concept of how to fix that was more power. So he went very Jeremy Clarkson, backed up a little bit, and just throttled that thing, and we hit and push up. And we started to go up, and then it lost power because it was just an old four-cylinder Toyota pickup. And it dropped back down, and we landed on the back bumper, and the truck was teetering like this. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, everything, the sun visors, the dash, the floor, everything, flies past us and lands on the back window. And yeah, and my cousin's like, I think I got it. So he puts it in four-wheel drive, and we tried the first time. We run up, and we just about broke the front wheels over the top, and it slipped and come back down hard on the back bumper. There again, start teetering, and he's like, I got it this time. He revs it up. I mean, he had to redline it, drop the clutch, and we literally rocketed up the side of this cliff and then was airborne and just sat there for a minute. And then we finally landed on the top of the ledge. The engine evidently was just heavy enough that it pushed the front end down. We landed on the back wheels, then collapsed onto the front wheels and bounced. Luckily, we didn't fall back down into the hole. He literally rocketed that thing right up on top of the ground. And the guy, his friend just sat there and goes, it's impossible. How did you do that? And my cousin, being the Toyota fan that he is like, it's a Toyota, you know, and he's carrying on. And the guy goes, you got lucky. You'll never do it again. And my cousin's like, yeah, watch this. And I'm like, nope, I survived the first one. I'm out. I jumped out the truck. I'm like, yeah, no, you're crazy. We should have never done it the first time. Sure enough, he pulls down. Like I said, I got out of the truck. Nope. And he went down, done the exact same thing again, and landed it exactly the same way again. And I'm like, Toyota for life.
Man, that is quite a story. If we're telling off-roading stories now, I have quite a funny story about when me and my cousin took a golf cart through the woods.
Uh-oh. Perfect TikTok story.
So up in the, I guess, kind of very wooded areas of Vermont, my uncle and my cousin both have houses. My uncle's is like a summer house that he doesn't live in year-round, and my cousin lives a 12 months out of the year in his house with his wife. And so my uncle has a golf cart at his house, And we were all over, though, I guess, summer of 2019, we all went over to my uncle's house. And me and my cousin were like, okay, let's go take the golf cart out and let's see if we can go through these woods. And so there's this pathway out in the backyard that leads us to the woods. And so we take the golf cart out, and I don't know why I was dumb enough to think, yeah, Cousin Shane, can I drive? So I'm here driving this golf cart through the woods. And there's, you know, and it's a golf cart, so it's not meant to go off-roading, obviously. So we're going over these tree stumps, and these big branches, and these, like, little, like, mini, like, stones, and, like, little small boulders and stuff. And honestly, at one point, there was this tree that was on top of, that was like right next to a small boulder, and we kind of went up onto the boulder, and half of the golf cart, like the passenger side, was on the boulder. It was like next to the tree on this lifted boulder, and then we had the other half, my half, on the flat ground. And I'm like, okay. And this boulder was about a foot and a half, 2 feet tall. Which for a golf cart to be on that, like that, at an angle like that, is kind of, that's sketchy. So I'm like, you know, I'm not gonna drive this thing out. I do not wanna die in an autoerotic accident having been crushed by a golf cart that's not even mine. So I'm like, cousin, I'm gonna hop out, you go and solve this issue, and if you die, well, my deepest condolences, but for this one moment, I gotta be selfish and just take care of myself, make sure I don't die. So we did eventually get it out, but then we had the stupidity to keep going. And at this point, my cousin is driving, and he has what's known as a lead foot. He likes a bit of speed and power, you know, to the full Jeremy Clarkson power. So we're going down this hill, and at the end of the hill, there's a big, like, pool of mud. And we go down the hill straight into the mud. And guess what happens? You just know what happens. We got full on stuck.
Mm-hmm.
In this mud. And we had to, he had to get out and push it. Well, I gave it the full beans, like full on power to try to get out of this mud. But we tried to back it out so we could get out of the mud and then go back up the hill and just turn back and go back home. Because we're like, yeah, this is getting a bit too sketchy. We don't want to mess around with this. And I kid you not, it must have been 5 or 10 minutes of just solid, like, full throttle pushing back, trying to get back up this hill. And I mean, we did eventually get it out and get back home. But I at one point I thought to myself, how am I still alive? Like, how have I survived this incredibly strange, messed up, dangerous thing?
Yep. First of all, you're in a golf cart. I mean, you know. Most of them are probably at best one-wheel drive, so, you know, the fact you made it that far is amazing.
There's no such thing as a four-wheel drive golf cart, at least not that I've seen. Maybe sure, somewhere in the world there is a four-wheel drive golf cart, but not that I've seen. And we definitely did not have one of those. So, yeah. I thought, this is just the end.
I know
that's the end of done.
I know you were pitching it as something stupid, but I would pay money to do that. Like, three teams each, like two teams of three, one golf cart each, paintball guns. That would be in the forest. That would be something.
Have a little competition, see who can get the furthest on the through the woods.
No, a paintball gun competition, but each team has a golf cart.
Yes.
Ooh.
Yes. Someone drives, and then someone else is the gunner.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That sounds like fun. Well, besides, you know, the ditch thing with my cousin, the closest I ever thought off-roading, I thought my life was truly in danger. Actually, there's probably a couple of them, if I really think. But the worst one, I was on my quad runner, and I was with my dad and a friend of ours, and we was running where the old railroad was, and they tore up all the tracks, the rails, all that was gone. So it was just nice, flat, and we said, hey, let's see where these go. And they had went down into the woods off to the side and got ahead of me, and I thought, well, I'll catch up with them. And I stayed up where the track should have been, so it was nice, flat, and level. I was running 30 mile an hour probably, trying to catch up with them because they was a bit ahead of me, and I wanted to beat them to where we was going. And there again, like your friend, I have a bit of a, well, in quad runner terms, I have a lead thumb because your throttle's actually activated with your thumb. Yeah. And I was screaming. Well, the old adage of never take your eyes off the road. Yeah. Well, I was catching my dad and his friend, and I was looking down the hill through the woods to see him. And little did I know, on these railroad tracks that had been clear for miles, a railroad tie stuck out in the middle about that far.
Ooh.
And I didn't see it. And I hit it with my right front tire, running 30, 35 mile an hour. And what happened was I remember a very violent push with the steer or the handlebars in, and I went over the handlebars and left. While I was airborne, I watched my quad runner go airborne, land on all four wheels, and continue down the railroad path. And meanwhile, I'm flying airborne, land, start rolling down this hill. How I did not hit a tree while I was doing this, I have no idea. And I ended up on my back, and I can still hear my quad runner flying down this trail, and then I hear a crash sound and have no idea what had happened. And I'm laying there, half got the wind knocked out of me, curious if I can move, because I'm like, okay, am I impaled on anything and just don't know it yet? Is something broke I don't know about yet? I know this arm hurt terribly. I was wondering if it was broke, but I could move it. So I wondered, when the handlebars just pushed back from hitting that, if I just didn't stove it up. So after laying there for a minute, I hear my quad runner kind of finally die, basically. And I get up and stretch myself back. No one knows I've wrecked. No one. I'm just laying there all by myself, just, yeah. So I get up on all fours and start to crawl, realizing, well, the arm's not broke, but it ain't doing good. I look around. I have no helmet on, nothing. Just, yeah, this could have went really bad really fast. I get up. My quad runner's probably 150 yards out in front of me. How it made it that far, I have no idea, but it did. And I start walking down the path, and meanwhile, I see my dad and his friend pull up onto my quad runner, and they're looking around like, well, where's he at? And here I am, stumbling down the path. I got my arm held up like this, and I'm just stumbling because I hurt. I mean, everything hurt. And I get up, and I'm still just trying to figure out, how am I alive? How did that not kill me, you know? And I get up to my quad runner, the handlebars are all bent, the alignment's out of place, and I'm like, we're miles into the woods. I mean, miles into the woods. And I'm like, oh God, please let it start. Amazingly, nothing was actually broken. And our friend that was with us was an actual ATV dirt bike mechanic. So, hey, you know. And luckily, we carry tools with us every time, so we were actually able to straighten up the handlebars, and he got my alignment fixed enough that we could get out. But instead of saying, you know what, that's a really bad omen, let's just turn around and leave, we continued on and finished out the rest of the day riding around, and then left later. But I tell you, man, that hurt something terrible. That was not a good experience.
What? Yeah. You see that? That is one of those classic moments of do not try this at home, kids.
Yeah. Well,
as objectocino, cuz.
Yeah, exactly. As my motto goes, in order to be old and wise, one must first be young and dumb. You know, and sometimes you just gotta hope to live through the young dumb state, you know, to make it the old.
Hope you live to see 22.
Yeah.
I don't have a story like that, but it does remind me of when I was somewhere in the neighborhood. I was with my dad's friend's son's friend who was on a bike. And he did a very similar thing where, because the brakes on the bike were really, I guess they were really grabby and really strong. He accidentally squeezed all the way down on the front brake and just whoop, twice, like two or three times, almost in a row. He just kept forgetting. I have never seen someone just get yeeted so quickly off of a bike like that. It was like insta stop and they just flew.
Yeah.
I hope he had a helmet on.
He did not.
Oh boy.
Nope, and it was on hard tarmac that he fell on. So he was fine, I think, the first two times. I don't remember about the third time, but yeah, that was a little. It was. It's funny now.
So.
There is something funny and terrifying about watching a human being going from, you know, kind of okay to airborne immediately.
You know, and
you get that ragdoll effect of just seeing them going through the air and you think, this ain't good. You
know? Exactly.
This is a bad situation.
Yeah. Well, when we were little, I was probably, well, I was only about fourth grade at the time, so take that for what it is. And there was a long driveway beside our house, and it was a mix of dirt and gravel and potholes. And us kids was all on our bikes, as neighborhood kids did back in the day. And of course, our big thing was, you know, ramping our bikes. That was huge. So being the resourceful children that we were, we found a couple cinder block, and we thought, well, there's the elevation part. So we start stacking up, you know, cinder block up. And we was up, I think it was either two or three block high at the time. Well, the only thing we could find for an actual ramp up the block was this metal grating. So, you know, this is going to go well. And it wasn't like heavy metal grating. So it had some flex when you hit it. So when you hit it, it would bend in and that would make your approach even steeper. And so you just shoot straight up in the air and come back down. Well, you're in fourth grade. This is fantastic, you know. So we had been doing this for a while. Well, my neighbor, Josh, at the time, his bike wasn't the best bike in the world. And we didn't realize he always had problems with his handlebars going forward on him while he was riding because the gooseneck of his bike just didn't seem to want to tighten good enough to keep him upright. Well, after several ramps and everything, you know, Josh decides to get a big old run for it because he was wanting to get the highest and furthest jump, of course. That's the goal. And he went airborne, and when he went airborne, his handlebars went completely forward on him. So what that done was it kind of threw him over the handlebars, and he was in a Superman pose, and his bike was still between his legs, but he was not really holding on anymore. And he landed on his neck, chin, and face in the gravel. And we watched him with his legs were still in the air, and his bike was still between his legs, sliding down this dirt gravel road, basically on his chin and face. And yeah, there was quite the trail of blood. This is going to get bad. And behind him. And when he stood up, he literally had rocks embedded into his face. Well, before, you know, being children, we don't think, hey, are you okay? We did do the sensible thing and immediately ran to go get our parents and say, hey, there's been a horrible accident. There's blood everywhere. So they throw him in the car, rush him to the hospital where they had to literally remove the rocks from inside his face. And he comes back home with just bandages wrapped. He had like one eye he could see out of. Yeah, it was bad. He didn't ever, as far as I know, ramp a bicycle again. again, young and dumb. I had a lot of them. And I remember that. I'll never forget that day because I was standing in what was my side yard of our house at the time when it happened, which is maybe 10 foot from where he was at. And I just remember watching him going, oh, and then it was like, you laugh because it was just that ragdoll, you know, effect. Yeah. And then when you realize what was actually going on, you're like, oh, you know, it's just, and then once I seen him smash his face into the ground and just legs and everything on straight in the air. I mean, he was bent like a taco, just sliding on his face. And it was just the most horrifying but yet amusing thing all at the same time. It's amazing how the human brain deals with things.
Yeah. See, the initial reaction was the real reaction. And then the second reaction was the human compassion reaction of, ooh, I shouldn't be laughing at this.
Yeah, and then you're like, but like, hell, you know, and I felt so bad because later that night, I mean, we were neighbors. So when I knew he was home and kind of settled in, I ran over to check on him. And there he is, all bandaged up. He was all messed up. And he was telling me what happened in the ER. And I spent the night with him, hung out with him. And, you know, I spent a couple of days just chilling with him. And because he couldn't do nothing. He was so tore up. And, you know, so compassion come definitely later. Once, as you're a child, you know, reality kicks in, you realize this ain't good.
Yeah.
This ain't
good. That makes me think of yet another golf cart story. This time not going through the woods. And this time it was my other uncle's golf cart. My mother's sister's husband, and they have this kind of big, like, ranch-style house out on Long Island in New York, and they have a pretty solid, like, 6 acres where you can just drive around on the golf cart and have fun. There's this big sloping driveway that kind of comes down this big hill, and you go down, there's, like, a cul-de-sac, and then there's the house at the front door and everything. And so, me and my uncle had taken the golf cart all the way up to the top of that big driveway with the hill. And I said to him, okay, I want to try to power slide this golf cart. I want to try to power slide this golf cart. And he said, okay. And, you know, I kind of, hindsight now, I'm like, how did he not stop me from doing that? Because he's a sensible adult. He should have been able to think, no, don't do that. That's a dumb idea. But he was like, okay, give it a shot. So I did. And I slammed right into the flower bed. And then I had the infantile stupidity later on the next day to try it again, except in a different place. Like a big gravel cutout, those down the street from the house next to another neighbor's house. There's this big like gravel cutout where like visitors can park and stuff. And so I tried to power slide on the gravel. And so the seat of the golf cart, because the golf cart was quite old. It was like a, you know, maybe 10 or 15 years old, which for a golf cart is pretty freaking old. And so the seat was no longer fully attached to the body.
Oh!
You can see where this is going. So, you know, going down the street, full speed, which was only about 10 or 15 miles an hour, but still. And turn hard right into the gravel section, and I kind of swing it around. And because the seat wasn't fastened down, the seat and my uncle just kind of slid, slid off.
Oh no!
Projected them in a corner like goodbye.
They land in the gravel.
Cody, that's the true ejecto seat, cuz.
That's what I would think, the ejector seat.
Somehow, I find myself sitting on top of the engine, because the engine is straight below the seat. So I'm like, oh hell, I'm sitting on top of this hot engine. But my uncle, I was okay though, because I didn't get ejected from the golf cart. My uncle though was sitting, he had landed on his hindquarters in the gravel, with the seats no longer under him. So he landed straight on that gravel on his backside.
Mm.
And for 1 second I was like, but then I was like, oh no, no, no. I was like, you okay? Like, do you have anything broken, interposed, cracked? Like, he ended up being pretty okay.
Just proof losing, proof that human compassion does have turbo lag.
Yeah,
exactly.
100%. Although, wouldn't it have been funnier if he was still sitting there on the seat, though?
Yeah.
I mean, just.
Yeah.
If him and the seat had flown out of the golf cart in perfect proportion while he was sitting on the seat flying through the air and just lands on the gravel still sitting on the seat.
That would have been hilarious. I'm sorry, but it would have been.
Those Disney moments. One of those children Disney moments.
Yeah.
I'm just thinking, if he landed on with the seat would have dug into the gravel and he would have rolled over. If he was still on the seat. Yeah.
He would have ended up like Josh from Doug's story. He would have been on his face spinning around.
Oh, this has just turned into story time now.
Okay. Slightly gruesome story time.
Meanwhile, I had a PlayStation.